Welcome. Today we begin a journey through the season of Lent. The journey mirrors the journey of life. And like life, this journey invites us to journey in trust. Trust in each other, trust in God, and trust in where we need to be in life. Along the way, there are signposts that mark our path. Each week, we invite you to pause and reflect on the signposts along your journey. Welcome to Lent. Enjoy the journey. We are called to worship. Through healing waters, through troubled waters, through still waters, through dangerous waters, through welcoming waters, God is with us. Come, let us worship. We join together in our opening prayer. We are grateful, Creator, for sacred water that flows in our bodies and through the earth. Water is a powerful force that both creates and destroys, sustains and erodes, deposits and washes away. Yet water is wasted, polluted, and ignored. In this time together, may we seek to restore good relations and remember all the ways your water is a gift of life. Amen. During this time of confession, you are invited to take a moment of reflection on these questions that mark our journey. When have you been cast into the wilderness, away from your comforts, strengths, and support? What has tempted you away from God's life-giving path? Who have been angels or messengers of God during your wilderness times? When have you forgotten God and God's covenant with us all? For what do you seek forgiveness? It is tempting to think we have all the answers. Forgive us, God, for the times we give in to temptations and turn away from you. Lead us in your way, we pray. A rainbow reminds us of God and God's promise. God loves all creation with a love that is steadfast and true. God forgives us and sets us free to live. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our storytelling for today is a dove's story based on Genesis 9, 8 through 17. I was in the dark for a long time, sitting on a beam in the corner of the ark. It was hot, sweaty, and noisy. So when Noah came down and asked me to leave and find solid ground, I was happy to do it. I searched and searched. It was so good to feel the wind on my wings. Finally, I found a plot of land with a tree on it. I took a twig and returned it to Noah. He looked relieved. Now we are all back on land. The waters are gone. I could have flown away immediately, but I'd come to care for Noah and his family. I wanted to stay nearby. The waters left a big mess. There was so much more work ahead for the land to be livable again. We were all tired, but we got to work making nests, making a home. One evening, not long after we exited the ark, something happened. The cool air got suddenly warm. The buzzing bugs were silent. The wind died. The clouds opened and a beam of sun came through. Noah sat in its light. He was silently leaning forward. His head bobbed and nodded from time to time as if he was listening intently. When he looked up, a rainbow appeared. It stretched from one side of the sky to the other, vibrantly shining red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. For a moment, we all looked on. And then the moment passed. The air became cool again. The bugs started to hum. The wind returned. But the rainbow stayed. It didn't fade. "What just happened, Father?" asked one of Noah's sons. Noah cleared his throat. "God just spoke." There was a pause. Everyone stopped. "God has made a promise," Noah started. "Not just with us." He looked at his family, now gathered around him, but with everything. Noah looked past his family, to the animals, the trees, and the land. He even glanced at me as I sat watching from a nearby tree. "Never again will God cover everything in water. God loves the earth and everything on it, every person, every plant, and every animal. Everything is included in God's promise. You, me, and all future generations. Everything is included." Noah's eyes returned to the rainbow, still bowed overhead. "That," said Noah, pointing, "is the sign of God's promise." That beautiful rainbow reminds us of God's promise that love and peace are more powerful than anger and hurt. And every time the rainbow appears, the promise is remembered. "What do we do now?" asked one of Noah's sons. Noah gave a small smile. "We'll see," he said. Our scripture lesson for today is from Genesis 9, verses 8 through 17. "Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, 'As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal on the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth.' God said, 'This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." It's interesting that we begin the journey of Lent with the end of another journey, a rather famous journey. We're all familiar with the story of Noah and the Ark. Probably we all had little Ark toys which we could march the pairs of animals up on. It's even depicted in the walls of our church nursery and many others, I imagine. The story is a children's Bible favorite because of the animals, I would think. But the story is much more complicated than that, as you know. In the story, the flood is not just some natural disaster. It is God who brings floodwaters, saving only Noah and his family, whom God deems righteous, and the animals, of course. So before it is a story of promise, it is a story of disaster, retribution even. You know, sometimes our journeys take a dark turn. Loss, heartache, illness, struggle. And sometimes we want to see them as God-created trauma, that somehow something we have done has brought this tragedy on us. But our passage for today reminds us how the story ends, with promise. Once Noah and the ark are safely on dry land, God promises never to destroy the earth again. And that covenant is marked by the sign of promise, a rainbow. Each time we see it, we are to remember God's promise, and God will remember too. The covenant promise part of this story reminds us that no matter where the journey takes us, God's good news remains the final destination. It's often hard to remember that when we're in the midst of struggle. If the season of Lent is a season that invites us into the journey and to delve deeper into our lives, what can we learn from our reading today that might inform our journey? For Noah, the signs of promise were clear. But we need to remember that that was not throughout the journey. The dove returns with the branch to let Noah know that the waters are at last receding and dry land is available. But when Noah set out on the journey, he and his family had no idea where the journey would lead, how long it would last, what they would encounter on the way. And many times Noah sent that dove out, and many times it returned empty-beaked. Certainly there are times when Noah wondered if the flood would ever end. And once the floodwaters receded, God provides a rainbow as a sign of the promise and makes it clear to Noah just what that rainbow represents. What are the signs of promise along your journey? How do you experience those signs of trust when you feel like you send that dove out over and over again, but still you keep going? What are the rainbow moments in your life's journey that sustain you? Now, we don't all get the voice of God telling us what the sign is and what it means. So how do we know what we're looking for? We know there are obvious signs of covenant promise in our lives: wedding rings, baptismal vows, the first buds of spring, even. But there are less obvious signs, too. I'll give you an example. I once knew a woman who was dying. She had long fought cancer, and now it had metastasized throughout her body. She was young and full of promise. But all medical science could tell her at this point in her journey was that she only had weeks to live, and there was nothing more they could do for her. They told her to go home, get her affairs in order, Although, how do you do that when you're young and there isn't much to organize? So what did she do? She bought a new car and she registered for classes at the university. Now, people thought she was crazy. And when she did pass away midway through the first semester, her folks sold her car and people wondered about the waste of money that whole endeavor had been. But that commitment to her future was what she needed to do. I've heard it time and time again. We covenant to choose to live until the end rather than to wait to die. You know, it's interesting that one of the things about this promise of the rainbow in this story is that it represents a never again promise. It's not connected to a covenant to do something, but to not do something. For God is to never destroy the earth again through flood. We too have our never again promises where we commit to refraining or abstaining. Some of those promises have come through hard lessons and others just a whim. Some last a season, like giving something up for Lent. Some are a lifelong commitment that is renewed every day, like recovery. So what are the never again promises in your life's journey? And what are the signs and symbols of those covenants? This season, we are invited on a journey. This journey explores our faith, the faith story, and our connection to God and with each other along the way. There are signposts, trail markers on the journey too. Some are signs of promise and covenant, and others points of direction and clarity. As we embark on the journey, we begin with a reminder that God goes with us. We are open to the signs God puts in our path, and we hope that delving a little deeper will reveal new truths about God and ourselves. Like all journeys, we don't necessarily know where it will lead or what we will encounter along the way. We may have to send that dove out over and over and over again until we know the road ahead is clear. But we do know that we travel to the cross and to resurrection. We do know that new life awaits ahead of us. How we travel there and what we encounter along the way can serve to enhance the destination if we let it. I close with a poem by James Healy entitled Starting Point. Whether we gaze longing into the garden or with fear and trembling into the desert, of this we can be sure. God walked there first. And when we who have sinned and despoiled the garden are challenged now to face the desert, we do not face it alone. Jesus has gone there before us to struggle with every demon that has ever plagued a human heart. Face the desert we must if we would reach the garden. But Jesus has gone before us. Amen. Let us join together in dedicating our gifts. Let us pray. Creator God, in all that we do, all that we say, and all that we give, may we live out your covenant for all creation. Amen. As always, we begin our time of prayer with a few moments of silence for contemplation. And there are moments of contemplation sprinkled throughout this service. They are opportunities to be still, to be in the presence of God, to lift to God the thoughts of our hearts and minds, and to know God's presence with us. Let us pray. To you, O God, we pray. In you, O God, we trust. For you, O God, we wait. Lead us so that we may always follow in your way. Teach us so that we may remain steadfast and faithful. Remind us of our covenant, so that we may be a covenantal people, striving to care for all of creation as you care for us. Where there is brokenness and discord in your creation, where there is death and dying, where there is isolation, exile, and forced migration, please send reminders of your love, and where possible, help us to be your messengers. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our blessing for today is a commissioning adapted from Meister Eckhart. Love God in all things equally, for God is equally near to all creatures. And among these creatures, God does not love any one person more than any other. God is all and is one. all things become nothing but God. Apprehend God in all things, for God is in all things. If we spent enough time with the tiniest creature, even a caterpillar, we would never need sermons. So full of God is every creature. Go and spend time in God's creation and in the amazing presence of God in all things. Amen. Thank you.